If an advanced race of beings came to visit Earth today, they'd find nothing more than a bunch of psychotic, hairless apes murdering each other over which bit of dirt was theirs. But if they visited 100 million years from now, what would be waiting for them? What would our world be like? Would we still be here? And if not, what has taken our place? Let's find out as we explore what the Earth will look like in 100 million years. At 5, time for new maps. From a distance, the Earth would look much as it does today, with random splotches of green bursting out from a carpet of ocean blue. That's if we've not concreted over the land and dyed all the seas red with Kool-Aid. But if the explorers were to somehow come across a depiction of our Earth today and compare it with what lay before them, they would see a monumental difference thanks to continental drift. Continental drift describes the movement of the Earth's continents due to the movement of tectonic plates beneath them. And it is this which causes mountains to be formed, earthquakes to occur, and it's also why South America and Africa look like puzzle pieces that should fit together. It's because once upon a time, they did. And over the next 100 million years, this will continue, as both North and South America journey on westwards, eventually merging with Asia to form Amasia. Good luck building a wall to stop that. But America won't have Asia all to itself, as Australia also starts to get chummy with Indonesia, South Korea, and the rest by gradually moving northwards. Meanwhile, Africa will also shift north as the Mediterranean ceases to exist, with a brand new mountain range forming across the current location of the Persian Gulf. Eventually, this moving of the continents is expected to lead to the formation of one supercontinent called Pangaea Proxima, or Pangaea Ultima, depending on who's in charge at the time. But it's not just plate tectonics which will affect the look of Earth's continents, as with all of the Antarctic ice expected to have melted within 50 million years, rising ocean levels will see huge bodies of water encroaching into Central Africa and the Americas, with an expanded Baltic Sea also likely. Furthermore, many of the landmarks we recognize today will be long gone in 100 million years' time, with most vanishing much sooner. Niagara Falls will cease to exist in 50,000 years. The Grand Canyon will broaden and erode into a valley in 2 million years. And even the Canadian Rockies will be nothing but a flat plain within 50 million years. But what about man? What will be left for us? Well, in all likelihood, not a lot. In at number 4, the end of mankind. To paint a full picture of what the Earth might look like in 100 million years, we have to consider who or what is likely to be living there at the time. But even according to the most generous estimates, it's thought unlikely that human beings will persist for so long, with our end date coming in somewhere between 10,000 and 10 million years, based on various interpretations of the doomsday argument. So, what might be here in our place? Who will be around to greet future explorers from other worlds? Well, there are an estimated 8.7 million species living on planet Earth, excluding bacteria, because the germ rights movement hasn't quite taken off yet. However, very few species around today are expected to survive the next 100 million years because both man and nature are colluding to wipe them out. Over the past 100 million years, there have been two major extinction events. The first was the Cretaceous-Paleogene event 66 million years ago, which took out 3/4 of all plant and animal life on Earth, including dinosaurs. This was probably caused by a combination of a comet or asteroid impact, plus the formation of the Deccan Traps. And maybe some climate and sea level change thrown in for good measure as well. However, the second major extinction event started 10,000 years ago, and this has just one cause: humanity. Thanks to man's activities, the diversity of life on Earth is decreasing at an unnaturally rapid rate. Fauna and flora are disappearing 1,000 times faster than the natural background extinction level, and it may be as high as 10,000 in the near future. Known as the Holocene extinction, this event is expected to kill off 30% of all known species over the next 100 years. So, over 100 million years, life on this planet will undoubtedly transform into something we cannot possibly hope to comprehend today. Will life develop from plankton, tardigrades? Or will a hybrid of geese and jellyfish rule the planet in our place? I do hope so. But whatever comes next, it's clear that Earth's life forms are heading for a major genetic bottleneck. And it remains to be seen what, if anything, will manage to squeeze through. In at number 3, a big hole. As we mentioned in the previous entry, we're almost certain that the previous mass extinction of life on Earth was at least partially caused by the impact of an asteroid or comet in Mexico's Yucatan Peninsula 66 million years ago. Such devastating events are thought to occur at least once every 100 million years, with mass or partial extinctions caused every single time they do. These large-scale impacts are so deadly because of pressure followed by ejected material re-entering the atmosphere worldwide to create planet-sized fires, not to mention all that fine dust remaining in the air turning to clouds that block sunlight, with the end result being a total and complete shutdown of photosynthesis the world over. This event could be caused by a stray object from the Oort cloud, from an asteroid hailing from outside our solar system, or even from the debris created when the Martian moon Phobos strikes its parent planet sometime in the next 50 million years. At this moment in time, we simply cannot predict when such an object will strike the Earth. All we know is that it's statistically likely to occur at least once over the next 100 million years. So, will Earth's inhabitants be prepared to act when it does? Or will it finish us all off for good? At 2, a warm glow. I hope those intergalactic explorers have brought their hazmat suits, because in 100 million years, the Earth might be ever so slightly radioactive, thanks to a local star going supernova. Supernova is a term used to describe the final cataclysmic implosion, explosion, which occurs when a high-mass star dies. When this takes place, the dying star emits gamma rays, and if these were to hit Earth, it could strip us of our ozone layer, leaving every single life form exposed to solar and cosmic radiation. It is estimated that supernova occur within 33 light-years of Earth once every 240 million years. So it's not inconceivable that another could strike within the next 100 million. The closest known risk comes from IK Pegasi, although this guy is expected to have moved to a safe distance by the time it's ready to pop. However, it's also considered likely that the next star to go supernova within striking distance of Earth has yet to be discovered or studied sufficiently to know exactly when it's gonna blow. So it could happen tomorrow, for all we know. But supernova aren't necessarily a negative thing when it comes to life. It certainly means bad news for us and anything else still hanging around at the time. But conversely, a supernova could kick off an entirely new chapter in the history of life on Earth or other nearby planets. So, while we humans may end up burnt to a crisp, it may be that the next supernova is merely preparing the Earth for our planet's next tenants. And I hope when they move in, they replace the sofa. Because some guy stayed over last week, and he had a really weak bladder. and in at number one? Hot or cold? Hooray! It's time for a climate change entry. So what's the answer? In 100 million years, will Earth be a ball of hot lava or a frigid ice world? Who knows? Could be either. The Earth has experienced 5 major ice ages that we know of, with the most recent kicking off 3 million years ago and continuing to this day. The reason we don't feel like we're in an ice age is because we're currently in an interglacial period. And according to some calculations, this may last for another 50,000 to 100,000 years. This delay is thought to have been caused by the man-made increase in carbon dioxide. But just because we've averted a few million years of snow days doesn't mean we should carry on doing this willy-nilly. In the short term, we're doing major damage to life on our planet, and this could quite easily lead to our extinction, as it's already doing for many other species. But in the long term, over millions of years, our impact on the planet is barely even relevant. So go ahead, smash up a load of bird's nests and drizzle radioactive goop into your local stream. Mother Earth doesn't give a hoot. Because while we may have delayed our planet's cooling at present, an eventual global drop in temperatures is inevitable, as is a rise in temperatures as well. If you look at the past 500 million years, you'll see there are frequent peaks and troughs, with periods of glaciation interchanging with much hotter climates. These dramatic changes taking place over millions of years illustrate a sobering fact that the Earth does not care about us. It was here before mankind existed, and it'll be here when we're gone. We can mess it up all we want, but all we'll do is wipe ourselves and any other life forms out of existence. Earth will remain, and over the next 100 million years, it will endure periods of both extreme heat and cold. If life does manage to persist in some form, it will have to figure out how to adapt to these changes and take advantage of the brief periods of stable climate. A break in the ice age allowed human civilization to develop. So once we're gone, whatever's left will need to take its chance when the window of opportunity is open. And that's our list. Did you enjoy it? I don't care. I hate you. And would you like to know why I hate you? Then watch this video on the 4 emotions that control everything you do.